Local programming on KRWG Public Media made possible in part by viewers like you. Thank you.
This is KRWG Public Media, TV, radio, online, news that matters. Now, across the Mesilla Valley and the borderland, the stories that shape our community. From the KRWG Broadcast Center at New Mexico State University, this is Newsmakers.
Thanks for joining us on this special edition of Newsmakers. I'm Fred Martino. The federal government says teachers and students who are fully vaccinated against the coronavirus don't have to wear masks indoors. But that guidance, published by the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, also recommends students and staff stay at least 3 feet apart to reduce the spread of a disease that is primarily transmitted through the air. Elsewhere in the U.S., schools and state officials have adopted a patchwork of rules for students and teachers. Some states, including Rhode Island, have done away with mask mandates for schools. Others are leaving the decision to districts. Illinois health officials say they are fully adopting the CDC guidelines. In California, state officials say that they are worried that imposing social distancing would make it harder for some schools to accommodate all students who return to classrooms. So they made a choice. California will not require physical distancing in exchange for everyone wearing a mask. My guest today is dealing with these issues too. Ralph Ramos is the new superintendent in Las Cruces Public Schools. Superintendent Ramos, thank you for being here today. And I want to begin with this topic as we record this. As you know, New Mexico has yet to announce its own guidance. But what do you think should be done in regard to precautions as we get ready to go back to school?
Thank you so much, Mr. Martino, for having me here. To answer your question, I think I know that Las Cruces Public Schools has been complying with our New Mexico Public Education Department recommendations. We call it the toolkit, and that's the big thing that the Bible that we follow, you know, to make sure that we comply with the Department of Health as well as the New Mexico PED department. Are looking at the CDC guidelines and trying to adjust, you know, accordingly to what our needs are in our state. And that's what we've been following all along. And, the thing that's made it really challenging has been, the toolkit changing periodically as we've lived and rode and weathered this storm of COVID. And currently right now, we still are in place. If you're not vaccinated, you have to wear a mask, and that goes along for all students, staff members. If we're going to be around students and if there's a summer program that's happening, we have to wear a mask as well anytime we're around students. Whether we're vaccinated as adults or not, that's what we have to do. On the other hand, athletics, is a big thing as well, and that's been very controversial because the New Mexico Athletic Association is allowing students not to wear a mask if they are vaccinated as well. On the other hand, the students that are not vaccinated have to wear that mask, and outside in these warm, hot summer days and, being competitive, it makes it pretty difficult, not only for athletics, but even for PE programs that we have going on in our district. Has made it challenging, and we're just really chomping at the bit to get the new toolkit to hopefully see some changes that correlate with the CDC guidelines, which at the national level, not all students have to wear masks. So it's a little difficult, although on the other hand, Las Cruces Public Schools, we are rule followers. In fact, we've kind of set the leadership on that. And, as superintendent, I need to make sure that we all comply and do the very best we can, being that we care about kids and our employees, and we want a safe learning environment, whether we're inside or outside.
Yeah. Now, of course, the COVID vaccination is available for those who are 12 or older. What about those who say require vaccination? This would make it easier for high schools where everyone's 12 and up, and perhaps most, if not all, middle schools as well.
Right. You know, and requiring everyone to get vaccinated, you know, we require students to get vaccinated for other, you know, things as well. But on the other hand, there's ways to opt out for different medical reasons and those type of things. I know one of the challenges even up in the governor's office is, and I've only heard, you know, rumors that there's a form, you know, that we're going to have to be filling out. And you hear all these rumors that are floating out there, you know, because, you know, that's part of HEPA violations and, you know, really impeaching on privacy of where you stand on vaccinations and who's vaccinated or not. But on the other hand, we're just kind of waiting for that toolkit to come out so we can comply, and maybe it might change, it may not.
Well, of course, as you know, New Mexico has already said that they will not require students to be vaccinated to go back to in-person learning. Of course, though, some colleges and universities have done this. They have said, if you want to have in-person learning and you want to live on campus, you're going to have to get vaccinated. New Mexico State and the University of New Mexico have not done this, but there have been schools, as you know, all over the country that have. What do you think about that?
You know, and I have to respect their campus, you know, and a lot of them, you know, they charge tuition. You know, we are a free, appropriate public education, you know, and we have to comply with our, you know, public of education department and those regulations. So that's what makes us different from others, you know, making those decisions. Now, on the other hand, there's probably districts, even in New Mexico, that are not complying with that. But you know what? I'm not going to put ourselves in that liability, you know, especially knowing that even the data always drives need, and the need drives change. And right now the data is, you know, from day to day, our numbers are still looking good, but then there's little days where, you know, they increase, and there's still pockets of COVID here in Doñana County. So, you know, in one sense, you know, half of me is like, let's not use masks at all. On the other hand, gosh, what if one of our employees or one of our students does, you know, pick up COVID from our lack of safety measures? And if we didn't comply, then I would really have a hard time living with that. And so to me, you know, have to balance that out and do what's best for kids, given the rules that we have to follow.
All right. Well, a question I know that you are getting, and you'll probably be getting a lot. When will playgrounds be open to the public again?
Excellent question. And, you know, when you start getting into playgrounds and campuses, especially when majority of our campuses are empty during the summer, you know, it's about monitoring the, you know, who's there during the day. Unfortunately, you know, some vandalism sometimes takes place, or there's people using our facilities that don't necessarily follow rules of, you know, things like that that are out there, that we're trying to just make it a safe learning environment. We do have two campuses, one Oronata Elementary, as well as East Picacho, who are open to the public, you know, pretty on weekends, as well as throughout the week. Actually, all campuses are open throughout the regular school day during the week. But on weekends, these two schools are open as a pilot to see what we're going to do. But I'm hoping that after July 30th, everything will be open back to normal with our playgrounds and campuses as well.
Okay. Another specific question for you, and you kind of indicated this fear in one of your answers. Even with precautions, we know that there will be some families who will still be very concerned about the COVID situation. So will remote learning still be an option for families?
Absolutely, super question. And you know, one of the things I gotta really commend Las Cruces Public Schools has been that we've always had a virtual learning academy in our district, and we've always tried to look at opportunities for kids, even at accelerated levels or medical reasons or whatever. We look at each individual student, you know, for their needs, their niche. What can we do to help them with their situation? And right now we have given students in our district, all students, a choice either to come in person, like we started this past semester, or to attend our virtual learning academy. And that's definitely still an option. And I know as data changes, as COVID changes, hopefully it gets behind us rather than again in front of us with all these new variants and all those type of things. But parents and families will continue to have those choices. I will assure you that. What makes it difficult on my end is to balance, your in-person teachers to meet the needs of kids that are attending. And let's say we lose an influx of 50 or 60 students to VLA the last minute, we're gonna have to make some adjustments. But I will tell you one thing, we've been planning ahead of this. We're looking at our preliminary data of 1,100 students that were gonna be attending VLA. So we made the adjustments for 30 teachers, 30 additional teachers to support that program. On the other hand, it was hard for my leadership team for us to cut the regular campuses where in-person is going to take place. So we're really waiting on numbers, but we're ready however it comes. We're now looking at some new data that has changed, that we're looking at about 300 VLA students, and that's K through 12. So, you know, things can change. We're ready for it. We're well prepared for it. And trying to meet that challenge. Yes, sir.
Yeah. So as you know, many students have really struggled with remote learning. What are some key takeaways for you as an educator when you're having to do this?
You know, key takeaways, and a lot of people talk about gaps in education and how much we've lost, learning losses there, you know, not only for students, but also for teachers, you know. But I got to be honest with you. Yes, you know, and we're going to be doing some initial assessments when students return back, you know, this coming fall. But it's not only about that. What have students gained? What have teachers gained? Our practice is so incredible. I mean, stop and think about this interview right now. We're doing it via Zoom. We've changed our style. We've learned new ways and learning and growing every day. And that's what COVID did to us. We've learned how to engage kids at a total level that we never have done before. Talk about technology and the awareness. What a celebration. Doñana County, Las Cruces, New Mexico, to know that every one of our students has access to a computer, one-to-one. You know, not only that, but also service of Wi-Fi connection, you know, whether we had to provide hotspots or, you know, do somersaults, whatever we had to do for every kid, you know, in our district to have those equal opportunities for all of them to learn, but also not only to learn, but to engage in discussions with the creativity that teachers really brought to the table. They are so resilient. And I know they were exhausted by the end of the day, you know, the end of the school year. But let me tell you, I know they're rested up. They're going to be coming back really more vibrant than ever. And I know that Las Cruces is going to do some great things for kids. And we're going to do things a little bit differently, because we've learned a lot through this COVID pandemic.
Well, I'm glad you framed it that way, because as someone who teaches college classes, I know that these young people in high school, it will be, they may not feel good about remote learning right now, but they will when they get to college, because they're going to have to use technology. And even for in-person college classes, they're going to have an online element of some kind. So they'll be used to it. And then just to kind of follow up on what you said in your answer, so the Las Cruces District was able, you're saying, to provide internet and provide a device for any student that didn't already have that.
That is correct. And we do continuous assessments. You know, one of the unique things that Las Cruces Public Schools did, and it's easy for principals, you know, just coming out of Camino Real Middle School, you know, we try to do the very best, you know, to provide this technology, but we really dug in deep. What devices do we have here to distribute now in the moment of crisis to make sure every kid had a computer? And then when we dispersed all our equipment, then we found the total number of how many additional devices do we have? And that's where our technology support and the planning there, you know, had computers coming in and we started distributing them. Not only that, now is that we need to really be thankful for the federal dollars that came in. I think what a great time for New Mexico legislation to really, you know, get involved now to really provide us the sustainability down the road, not these next 3 years. We have federal funds to really provide, and really it's been needed for a long time. And it's unfortunate that this pandemic had to take place in order to get all students and staff on a one-to-one device for technology type of learning. But to me, New Mexico is going to be challenged down the road 3 years from now, as technology tends to be obsolete at least every 3 to 4 years and getting new updated devices. How are we going to continue doing this for kids? You know, they keep saying New Mexico is ranked at the very bottom, you know, in our country. But now is the time. And I ask our leaders to really step up and join us, embrace, you know, our ideas to really make this happen, to do what's best for kids, because we have the teacher power, the teacher brain power and creativity to really do the right things for student learning. And I think it's just providing them with the right tools and all the right systems to make sure that we move up and be competitive at the national level.
Sure.
Because I know.
Let's talk about those tools. Besides technology, in your view, what are some other major things that are needed to ensure equity in our schools?
Well, curriculum. You know, I think curriculum needs to, you know, and it, I think New Mexico has a great system already in place where we vet it out. We have textbook adoption programs that go on, and we circulate that. I don't think that there's, I know in Las Cruces Public Schools, we don't lack textbooks or curriculum or things like that. To me, it's about having our standards aligned and our teachers being allowed to get creative to teach towards those standards and to really teach what's right and effective. You know, the days of starting in chapter one and ending in chapter 36 are really, those are over, they're behind us. Now it's about creative learning and how to make sure that we get the concept. I strongly believe that, you know, even like a typical math class anymore, you know, you and I probably were given 30, 40 math problems with homework and all of that. Why are we doing that? To me, give the kid five, you know, problems, if they master them, gosh, move them on to a new concept and let's keep building on their skill and looking at, you know, their proficiency skills with that to teach what we really need to teach rather than a lot of filler stuff. And to me, that's what's making it exciting, is new ways to teach, providing teachers with different tools to make them successful, to be able to engage kids in the classroom, plus making it exciting for them as well.
And of course, our viewers are familiar with one of the tools, which is giving students a chance to have an internship in their senior year. We had a young man on this program recently who had an internship at KRWG and actually produced a documentary during that internship. So that's a great thing. Another issue I want to move on to in terms of equity is a concern in terms of our textbooks and our lessons in our schools. As you know, recently at a Las Cruces school board meeting, there was quite a bit of pushback by some audience members over how Las Cruces Public Schools was working to ensure equity. What do you make of this controversy, which of course, by the way, is a national controversy? It's not just in Las Cruces, but we've seen this at school board meetings all over the country.
And that's a difficult question, sir, but let me tell you that one of the things that I participated in about a year and a half ago, right prior to COVID, was the cultural and linguistic orientation that they gave us, which I think a lot of people have misinterpreted. They're thinking it's a curriculum, no different than what I talked about a while ago, starting in chapter one, ending in chapter 36. And here we are learning every piece in that guide. This is actually a guide that's been given to principals. Some teachers have started learning and engaging and educating themselves about this guide that was provided to us. And it's all started with the Yazzie Martinez, case that took place, and equitable opportunities for all students. And I gotta be honest with you, there's some really good activities in that guide that really what we're trying to do is to pretty much educate teachers that there are multiple ways to educate students and they all come in red, white, and blue colors. And we need to respect them all and just level the playing field with them. And one of the things, and it kind of goes into my Mexican culture that I have, a lot of times it's hard when a teacher's talking to you, or anyone for that matter, for students to look at you directly into the eyes, and a lot of times students will just look down and talk, yes sir, no sir, still very polite, but a lot of times there might be a teacher that they find that offensive, but they don't understand the culture that comes out. So I think it's just little things like that to make a better knowledge, to respect every kid, whoever they are. One of the cool activities that we did at my school at Camino Real, when I went through this, we came back and every individual student during their advisory time got to research their own last name and where they came from, to be proud of whether you're Smith or Ramos or whatever your last name is, and your culture, and to be able to share things that you do in your family to celebrate. And it's unfortunate that there are some students that do tend to bully, okay? And that's going to be one of my goals this year, is that we commit every student, every adult, whether you're a parent, a teacher, a custodian, principal, to commit to no bullying, no violence, and no drugs. And with that comes three expectations: don't participate, walk away, and tell an adult. And to me, really, if we all come together with that, because even right when COVID was coming out, I had to deal with some racial comments, even as meaningful as calling students COVID, some of our Asian students. And, that's just not going to be acceptable.
And Superintendent, I think if people listen to your answer there, they'll get a better understanding of what your district and what many other districts around the country are trying to do. And it's basic good education, respect for others. But as you know, this has really become a political issue. Critics say that some politicians are using race as a political weapon, trying to rile up their base of voters, and that's driving some of this. What do you make of that?
Yes, sir. And I won't argue with that. I think that is, and it's unfortunate, because I think there's going to be a lot of good things that comes from this before it's all over. I think just number one is having respect for everyone, no matter who you are. And I think that's been pretty common, Las Cruces is a very diverse community that we live in, and a lot of great people.
And great teachers, by the way, too. And that brings me to another question that I think is really important.
Yes,
and I'd like you to answer it. We have seen some states, including Texas now, place restrictions on teachers who instruct students about race and other issues. Your thoughts about politicians getting involved in this way, actually passing legislation to restrict educators in the classroom?
I don't like to restrict teachers. I just think that if we are gonna, bring up a topic, it needs to be vetted out on both sides of the fence. Mm-hmm. But really, to be honest with you, to me, it's about the students facilitating those type of debates or discussions, you know, and really they're the ones that engage in that. And it's where the teacher has to be neutral on and see both sides. And it tends to be difficult. But I got to be honest with you, it's not like we're going to be, that's going to be part of our curriculum where we're going to have those type of things. It's no different than like current issues, you know, in an advisory class, you know, when current issues happen, whether it's weather, whether it's politics, whether it's, you know, whatever topic that's out there that's coming out with current issues, you know, teachers do engage in those and provide opportunities for students to take off and really learn from all the things that are going on in our world.
And as a longtime educator, you know this well, and I can remember back to being in middle school and high school, some of the best teachers I had really integrated that into the classroom to integrate current events, what's happening now, to help students really engage and understand the importance of what they were learning, that it applied to real life.
It does apply to real life. And a lot of times what happens is that, you know, really teachers aren't the ones that always bring these topics up, okay? What happens is sometimes there's, you know, catastrophic events that happen and the kids are, that's where their brain's at. You know, that's anything.
After all, we just had an attack on our very own U.S. Capitol. And so students have, I can't imagine the questions in the classroom. And so it's so important that teachers and administrators such as yourself don't feel like by educating students that they're going to ever be in the political crosshairs, because that could really hurt education. Believe it or not, we're out of time, and I appreciate you joining us for a half hour today to kind of talk about some of these really important issues, and we wish you well in the year ahead as you start your first full school year as superintendent in Las Cruces Public Schools.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much for having me here, and you know, we're looking forward to a great year. God bless everybody, and we're looking forward to some great things this year. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you for being with us. That is our time for now. Join us this week on KRWG Radio. Every weekday, it's Morning Edition from 5 to 9, Fresh Air at 11, followed by Here and Now, noon to 2, and All Things Considered, 4 to 7. KRWG News, always online at krwg.org, and we'd love to hear from you. Email us with story ideas and video submissions. The address is feedback@nmsu.edu. For all of us at KRWG News, I'm Fred Martino. Have a great week. We'll see you next time on Newsmakers.